Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AIS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis and their page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping of the discussed articles are provided in the description and also in the comment section for the benefit of the viewers. Now let us move on to the analysis of first news article. This news article is with reference to the rise in tensions between China and Taiwan. The news article states that Taiwan is organizing military drills to counter potential threat from China. In this context, let us try to understand why China and Taiwan are hostile neighbors and why China considers Taiwan as its own province and naming it as Chinese Taipei. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. So to understand the ongoing tussle between China and Taiwan, we have to go back to 17th century. See, it is in the 17th century, in the year 1644 AD, the last imperial dynasty of China was established. And this dynasty is called as Qing Dynasty of China, or it is also called as Qing Dynasty or Manchu Dynasty. This dynasty ruled China until 1911-1912. This dynasty, it gained control of the Taiwan geographical territory in the late 17th century. Close to two centuries later, Japan acquired Taiwan in the year 1895. This is after the First Sino-Japanese War. However, with the defeat of Japan in the World War II in 1945, Taiwan was returned to the nationalist Chinese control. But we have to note that in the year 1949, Chinese communists led by Mao, they defeated the nationalist forces on the mainland and established People's Republic of China in the year 1949. As a result, the nationalist leader Chiang Kai-shek moved his government, party and military from China to Taiwan. So this resulted in the separation of Taiwan from China. While mainland China, the government there is known as People's Republic of China, we should know that the government in Taiwan is called as Republic of China. Now coming to the geographical location of Taiwan, see it is located in the Western Pacific between Japan and the Philippines. It is located south to the East China Sea and it is located off the southeastern coast of China. At the international level, we should know that it was Taiwan which represented China in the United Nations till October 1971. On October 25, 1971, United Nations General Assembly voted to admit People's Republic of China and to expel the Republic of China, that is Taiwan. Therefore, the People's Republic of China assumed the place and position of Republic of China or Taiwan's position in the General Assembly and also in the United Nations Security Council. And after this, Chiang's government in Taiwan, it quickly lost its international standing with the politics and pressure of the mainland Chinese government at various international arrangements in which earlier Taiwan was a part. Now, if you come to the present stance of China with respect to Taiwan, China maintains that Taiwan is integral to its territory. That is, Taiwan belongs to China. But this is disputed by people and the government in Taiwan and also few other countries. So now what steps China may take, you know, to integrate Taiwan to itself? It bullies with its military might, saying someday or other it can generate some international pressure so as to annex this part. And we are seeing in recent days, particularly in the post-COVID-19 scenario, China is aggressively changing what was the status earlier with India and several other countries in South China Sea. With respect to maritime dispute with Philippines, China also called null and void an order of the Permanent Court of Arbitration as well. Well, this was earlier. In the recent days, we could see China aggressively changing status quo with its several neighbors. Recently, we discussed about its role in Bhutan as well. That is with reference to Sakteng Wildlife Sanctuary of Bhutan. Seeing all these developments, Taiwan prepares to maintain its territorial integrity and therefore it prepares its military for a possible aggression from China. In addition to this, Taiwan is trying very hard to get international recognition for its sovereignty and also for its representation in many international bodies. But in all such bodies, China is strongly opposing Taiwan's effort to get international acceptance. China's claim is Taiwan will be represented only by itself as it is an integral part of Chinese territory. That is, a territory of People's Republic of China. And with reference to this, recently we saw an issue with the World Health Organization as well, where Taiwan urged WHO to allow it to rejoin as an observer. This was condemned by China and Taiwan was not allowed to rejoin as well. In this scenario, few days back, the upper house of US Congress, that is the US Senate, it has passed a bill seeking the restoration of Taiwan in WHO. So in brief, know that currently Taiwan is ruled by its own government and not by China. And China considers Taiwan as its integral part, as Chinese Taipei, while Taiwan considers itself as a sovereign nation, Republic of China. And before 1971, Taiwan represented China in United Nations, which was later replaced by the People's Republic of China or the government in the mainland China. So these are some of the important information with reference to the analysis of this news article. We discussed about the historical relationship of Taiwan with China and the present issues between the mainland Chinese government and the Republic of China in Taiwan. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This editorial is about recent judgment of Supreme Court, which is a fillip or boost to the rights of persons with disabilities. In this discussion, we'll see about background of the judgment. We'll also see about another important 2012 judgment with reference to persons with disabilities. The syllabus relevant for the analysis is highlighted here for your reference. First, let's see the background of the issue. See, the judgment of the Supreme Court is delivered to an appeal against the order of Punjab and Haryana High Court. A petition was filed by a person in this Punjab and Haryana High Court. The person is intellectually challenged to the extent of 50%. That is, he is a person with benchmark disability according to the Rights of Person with Disabilities Act of 2016. So here you can see how the definition of person with benchmark disability varies with the definition of person with disability. Now this individual has applied for a diploma course in fine arts for physically or mentally challenged students. He filed the petition challenging certain provisions of prospectus issued by the government college. He claims that there must be a bifurcation of the total available seats between physically challenged students and mentally or intellectually challenged students. He also demanded that mentally or intellectually challenged students should be exempted from taking aptitude test. Now, regarding the reservation of persons with disabilities, you should know that there are two important sections in the 2016 legislation. These are sections 32 and 34 of the Act. Section 32 provides for not less than 5% or at least 5% reservation for persons with benchmark disabilities. And this shall be given along with an upper age relaxation of 5 years for admission in institutions of higher education. And section 34 provides for not less than 4% or at least 4% reservation in vacancies in all government establishments. Then it provides for 1% reservation for those suffering from intellectual or allied disability or multiple disabilities. That is 1% reservation for persons suffering from blindness and low vision, 1% for persons suffering from deaf and hard of hearing. Like this, for the last two subsections, that is D and E, total reservation shall be at least 1%. So we can observe that around 87% of this reservation goes to physically disabled candidates. That is, the Act says at least 1% of reservation shall be for each of the category under A, B, C, and 1% total at least for D and E category. And within this D and E category, only D category deals with intellectual or mental disability. So this is where the petitioner demanded a bifurcation of total available seats between physically challenged students and mentally and intellectually challenged students. But the High Court of Punjab and Haryana, it dismissed the petition and noted that all persons with disability must be treated equally and no benefit shall be given to a class of disabled persons at the expense of another class. The court also rejected the demand for exemption from aptitude test as well. Here, additionally, based on 2012 case law of Delhi High Court, the petitioners argued that an intellectually or mentally challenged student is at least equally deprived as a student belonging to the persons belonging to scheduled caste or scheduled tribes. They argued that if aptitude test has to be taken, then minimum passing marks should be reduced to 35% as in the case of students belonging to scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. But this argument again was also rejected by the Punjab and Haryana High Court. Now, the 2012 case law is what is called as Anamol Bhandari versus Delhi Technological University. In this case, the court noted that the persons belonging to scheduled caste and scheduled tribes had been given 10% relaxation in the minimum marks required for admission. But candidates belonging to persons with disabilities, they were given only 5% relaxation. So Delhi High Court held that persons with disabilities should be treated at par with candidates belonging to scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. Now let us see on what basis Delhi High Court gave this judgment in 2012. Now, first is based on constitutional mandates that the Constitution of India ensures equality, freedom, justice and dignity of all individuals under Articles 14, 16 and 21. So here it implicitly mandates the same treatment for persons with disabilities as well. Secondly, it is according to National Policy of Persons with Disabilities of 2006. This policy noted the above constitutional mandate. Additionally, this national policy noted that education is the most effective tool for social and economic empowerment. And if you see, according to 2001 census, 51% of persons with disabilities were illiterate. Now, this situation saw less improvement if you compare with, according to 2011 census, 54% of disabled children with multiple disabilities never attended educational institutions. Also, 50% of children with mental illness never attended education institution. And overall, only 55% of the total disabled population are literates. Now, this means around 45% of persons with disabilities are illiterate, according to 2011 census. So, the national policy urged that if any meaningful rights are to be given to persons with disabilities, then prime importance is to be given to educate them. This is because disability may act as a major impediment in formal education. So based on these things, Delhi High Court recognized that without imparting proper education to persons suffering from disabilities, there cannot be any meaningful enforcement of rights of PWDs under the Constitution. Thirdly, with respect to the reservation and treatment for persons with disabilities, the Delhi High Court noted that persons with disabilities who belong to scheduled caste or scheduled tribes, they would automatically enjoy the benefit of relaxation available for scheduled caste and scheduled tribe categories, for example, like age relaxation or the cutoff marks or the minimum required marks, etc. But persons with disabilities belonging to OBC and general categories, they are treated differently. For example, they will have higher cutoff marks and other treatment. So the court observed that this is a differential treatment and is discriminatory to persons with disabilities of OBC and the general categories. So Delhi High Court noted that there is no reason why the benefits of candidates belonging to scheduled castes, scheduled tribes in general should not be extended to the entire class of persons with disabilities. Court noted that such a process only will bring parity among all persons with disabilities. That is, the understanding is that let the persons with disabilities across all categories, including OBC, general category, SC, ST, be considered as a single group and let them enjoy common benefits as a whole. So this will bring additional benefits, relaxations among the persons with disabilities as the same benefits. So based on these points, Delhi High Court ruled that people suffering from disabilities are equally socially backward as persons belonging to scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. So therefore, as per constitutional mandates, they are entitled to, that is the persons with disabilities are entitled to, at least the same benefit of relaxation that is given to scheduled caste and scheduled tribe candidates. So this 2012 judgment of Delhi High Court is important because in the recent case, when the petitioner filed an appeal to the Supreme Court upheld this 2012 judgment of the Delhi High Court and has passed order. Here note that Supreme Court first upheld the decision of Punjab and Haryana High Court with respect to bifurcation of total seats and exemption from aptitude test. The apex court noted that no exemption can be given. But it ultimately followed the principle that is laid down in 2012 judgment by the Delhi High Court. See, Supreme Court recognized the struggle faced by persons with disabilities in accessing education or employment, regardless of their social status. Therefore, it upheld that people suffering from disabilities are also socially backward. And therefore, at the very least, they must be entitled to same benefits as given to persons belonging to scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. So, Supreme Court held that 35% required to pass in the aptitude test with reference to persons belonging to scheduled caste and scheduled tribes, the same shall apply to disabled persons in future. Now, with respect to this Supreme Court verdict, there is one argument which is noted by this editorial that some experts observe that by eliminating the distinction between the disabled and the persons belonging to scheduled caste and scheduled tribes, there is an attempt to equate physical or mental disability with the social disability and the experience of untouchability suffered by marginal sections for several centuries. They argue that persons with disability from a traditionally privileged community has a better social background and advantage over those persons with disabilities suffering from historical social disability. Now, we saw in the census data that there is extremely low literacy rate among persons with disabilities, and this leads to low employment rates in general, and the persons with disabilities are deprived of a dignified life as well. So, to bridge this gap, the Right of Persons with Disabilities Act 2016 raised the reservation to 5% from the existing 3%. This 3% reservation was as per Persons with Disabilities Act of 1995. Note that the 2016 Act repealed this 1995 legislation. And one more salient feature if you talk about the 2016 law is that there is an enabling provision to provide incentives to employers in private sector. That is, government can provide incentives to the private sector to ensure that at least 5% of their workforce is composed of persons with benchmark disability. Finally, the government's role is to give full effect to these provisions so that persons belonging to disabilities among the population is not left out of social and economic advancement. Now, one main inference from this article discussion is that what the editorial implies is there must be a separate category of reservation and relaxation for all the persons belonging to persons with disabilities to give effect. They may be given a separate reservation, not within OBCs, not within SCSTs, and they may be considered at par with at least persons belonging to scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. So with this, we come to the end of analysis of this editorial. In this editorial, we saw the background of recent Supreme Court judgment. Then we discussed about the 2012 judgment of Delhi High Court, which was upheld recently by the Supreme Court. From this discussion, take note of the sections that we have discussed from Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act of 2016, as there could be a mains question on this legislation. Now let us move on to next news article. This news article is about maternal mortality ratio. Article notes that maternal mortality ratio in India has declined in the time period 2016-18. The data is provided by Sample Registration System, which is the largest demographic sample survey that provides direct estimates of maternal mortality through a nationally representative sample. This data is released by the Office of the Registrar General India under the Ministry of Home Affairs using Sample Registration System. See, maternal mortality in a region, it is a measure of reproductive health of women in the area. Many women in reproductive age span, they die because of complications during pregnancy, then following pregnancy and childbirth, or due to abortion. According to World Health Organization, maternal death is the death of a woman while pregnant or death of a woman within 42 days of termination of pregnancy. This is irrespective of the duration of pregnancy or the site or place of residence. Maternal death is related to causes related to pregnancy or causes aggravated by the pregnancy or management of such causes, but maternal death does not include accidental or incidental causes. That is, it does not include causes other than causes related to pregnancy. Now, know that one of the key indicators of maternal mortality is maternal mortality ratio. It is defined as number of maternal deaths during a given time period per 1 lakh live births during the same time period. Here, it is important for us to know about SDG goal that is related to it, which is goal number 3, good health and well-being. Under this goal, there is a target 3.1, which states that the aim is to reduce global maternal mortality ratio to less than 70 per 1 lakh live births. This is to be achieved by the year 2030. Now, where do India stand with reference to achieving this target? See, we are still far from achieving. According to recent SRS data, the maternal mortality ratio of India is 113 in the period 2016 to 2018. But this is seen as a success because MMR has actually declined from 122 in the time period 2015 to 17 and from 130 in the period 2014 to 16. So we can see a gradual reduction in MMR. Now, with respect to states, highest maternal mortality ratio is seen in the state of Assam, that is 215. This is followed by Uttar Pradesh, where it is 197. Now, there is one positive note, that is the southern states, which are Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Tamil Nadu, Kerala and Karnataka. For these states, the maternal mortality ratio is less than national maternal mortality ratio. That is, for these states, maternal mortality ratio is less than 113. And these states are classified as southern states as per the sample registration system. The better performer with respect to maternal mortality ratio is the state of Kerala with the number 43. And normally there is a confusion with respect to maternal mortality ratio and maternal mortality rate, but there is a slight difference. It was also noted in the recently released document by Ministry of Home Affairs. See, maternal mortality rate is the maternal deaths of women in the ages 15 to 49 per 1 lakh women in that age group. Now, this data related to maternal mortality rate is important, particularly to bring policy responses in general for reproductive health. Here we find that age group is given importance. Now, coming to maternal mortality ratio definition, it is defined as number of maternal deaths during a given time period per 1 lakh live births during the same period. So these are some of the important information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to next article. This news article is with reference to the political turmoil happening in the ruling Congress party in Rajasthan. The Rajasthan Assembly Speaker has issued disqualification notices to the Congress leader Sachin Pilot and some other MLAs. And these MLAs, they are moving to the High Court challenging the notice issued by the Assembly Speaker. For our today's analysis, let us talk about the Speaker, not in the State Legislative Assembly, but of the Lok Sabha and also the presiding officer of Rajya Sabha. Now, with reference to disqualification and matters related to the 10th schedule, we have discussed in detail on our 9th June 2020 Hindu News Analysis. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. See, each House of Parliament has its own presiding officer. In case of Lok Sabha, it is the Speaker. In case of Rajya Sabha, it is the Chairman. Now, coming to the Speaker of Lok Sabha is elected from its members. And whenever the office of Speaker falls vacant, the Lok Sabha elects another member to fill the vacancy of the Speaker. Now, the date of election of the Speaker is fixed by the President. And note that whenever the Lok Sabha is dissolved, the Speaker does not vacate her office and the Speaker continues till the meeting of newly elected Lok Sabha. Now, coming to roles and functions of Speaker, the Speaker is the head of the Lok Sabha. She is the guardian of powers and privileges of the members and also the guardian of powers and privileges of the House as a whole and also its committees. Know that the Speaker's decision in all parliamentary matters is final. The Speaker derives her powers and duties from three sources: the Constitution of India, the Rules of Procedure and Conduct of Business of Lok Sabha, and also from parliamentary conventions. Now let's see some of the powers and duties of Speaker. Her primary responsibility is to maintain order and decorum in the Lok Sabha for conducting its business. She is the final interpreter of the provisions of the Constitution within Lok Sabha, and also she is the final interpreter of the Rules of Procedure and Conduct of Business of Lok Sabha as well. And it is the Speaker who adjourns the Lok Sabha in the absence of a quorum. Here, quorum, when we say, it refers to 1/10 of the total strength of Lok Sabha. You should know that the Speaker does not vote in the first instance, but makes a casting vote in case of a tie. The Speaker of Lok Sabha presides over a joint sitting of two houses of parliament when such a sitting is summoned by the President. And with reference to money bill, it is the Speaker of Lok Sabha who decides whether a bill is money bill or not, and her decision on this matter is final. Now, apart from these, the Speaker also decides on the questions of disqualification of a member of Lok Sabha arising on the ground of defection under the 10th schedule. But as per earlier judgments of the Supreme Court, this decision of the Speaker is subject to judicial review. So generally we can see that a speaker is provided with security of tenure. The salaries and allowances are fixed by Parliament. They are charged on the Consolidated Fund of India. Therefore, they are not subject to the vote of Parliament. And the work and conduct of Speaker cannot be discussed and criticized in the Lok Sabha except on a substantive motion. The Speaker of Lok Sabha is given a very high position in the order of precedence. The Speaker is placed along with the Chief Justice of India. Now coming to the presiding officer of Rajya Sabha, it is the chairman. The Vice President of India is the ex officio chairman of Rajya Sabha. But when Vice President acts as President or when Vice President discharges the functions of the President, she or he does not perform the duties of the office of Chairman of Rajya Sabha. Know that the Chairman of Rajya Sabha can be removed from his or her office only if the person is removed from the office of Vice President. And as a presiding officer, the powers and functions of Chairman in Rajya Sabha are similar to those of the Speaker in Lok Sabha. However, there are 2-3 distinctions. The Speaker of Lok Sabha has 2 or 3 special roles that are not enjoyed by the Chairman. One, as we saw earlier, the Speaker of Lok Sabha decides whether a bill is money bill or not. Then the Speaker presides over joint sitting of 2 Houses of Parliament. Here we can see that Speaker is a member of a House. The Chairman of Rajya Sabha is not a member of the House. Therefore, the Speaker of Lok Sabha presides over a joint sitting of 2 Houses. In case Speaker is absent, it will be presided by Deputy Speaker of Lok Sabha. If Deputy Speaker is also absent, it will be presided by the Deputy Chairman of Rajya Sabha. If Deputy Chairman is also absent, then such other person as may be determined by the members present at the joint sitting will preside over the meeting. With this, we come to the end of the discussion related to this news article. We discussed about the presiding officers of both houses of Parliament. We saw the functions and powers associated with them. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is with reference to sero or serum sample testing done by the National Center for Disease Control. The center has told the Delhi High Court that the preliminary result of sero surveillance sample testing across Delhi will take at least another week. In this context, let us discuss in brief about the National Center for Disease Control, and we'll conclude the discussion by seeing also about the National Institute of Virology. Coming to this National Center for Disease Control, know that it is under the administrative control of Director General of Health Services of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. If you see the origin of this center, it is with the Central Malaria Bureau, which was established in the year 1909. Then a development happened in the year 1938 when the Central Malarial Bureau was renamed as Malarial Institute of India. Later, the activities of this institute were expanded so as to cover communicable diseases, and therefore in 1963 it was renamed as National Institute of Communicable Diseases. And a recent development happened in the first decade of the 21st century, that is in 2009. It was transformed into National Center for Disease Control with a larger mandate of controlling emerging diseases and re-emerging diseases. At present, this center is headquartered in Delhi. Now coming to its functions, very importantly, it functions as nodal agency in the country for disease surveillance, then facilitating prevention and control of communicable diseases. It functions in coordination with the state governments, and it has the capacity and capability for disease surveillance, outbreak investigation, then giving rapid response to contain and combat outbreaks. It is also having a separate division which deals with entomology and vector management with reference to diseases. We should know that the center is also dealing with antimicrobial resistance, which is an emerging area of concern. Now let's come to National Institute of Virology, which is often seen in the news. See, it is one of the major institutes of Indian Council of Medical Research. It was established in Pune in the year 1952 as a virus research center under the support of ICMR and Rockefeller Foundation of USA. It was an outcome of the global program of Rockefeller Foundation for investigating arthropod-borne viruses. However, in the year 1967, Rockefeller Foundation withdrew its support to the center, and since then, National Institute of Virology is entirely funded by ICMR. In 1967, it was also designated as one of the collaborating laboratories of WHO, and in 1969 it started functioning as the regional center of WHO for Southeast Asia for arbovirus studies, that is, any of the group of viruses that are transmitted by mosquitoes, ticks or other arthropods. Now know that this institute is also the national center for hepatitis and influenza. Now, the research areas of NIV include cell repository, electron microscopy, rickettsiosis, hepatitis, influenza and related viruses. It also includes clinical virology, biochemistry, virus registry and also biostatistics. So these are some of the important information with reference to the National Institute of Virology and also the National Center for Disease Control. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion. We have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. This question is with respect to the powers of Speaker of Lok Sabha. Three statements are given. Which of the statements given above are not correct? First statement, the Speaker decides whether a bill is a money bill or not, and here are his decision on this question is final. This statement is correct, so it should not be present in the option, so eliminate option A. Now, statement 2, in the absence of the Speaker, the Chairman of Rajya Sabha presides over a joint sitting of the two houses of the Parliament. This statement is incorrect. So, any statement must have this statement in the answer. Second statement, eliminate option D. Now, we have to find out whether third statement is incorrect or not. See, the decision of Speaker on disqualification of a member of the Lok Sabha on the ground of defection under 10th schedule is subject to judicial review. This statement is correct as per the judgments of Supreme Court, particularly the judgment made in the 1992 Kihoto-Holohan case. So we can find only the second statement is incorrect. Therefore, the correct answer is option C. Note that in the absence of Speaker, a joint sitting will be presided by Deputy Speaker. If Deputy Speaker is also absent, then it will be presided by Deputy Chairman of Rajya Sabha. This question is with reference to Taiwan. Consider the following statements. Two statements are given. Which of the statements given above are correct? Taiwan enjoys semi-autonomous status through the principle of one country, two systems. This statement is incorrect because one country, two systems policy is implemented in Hong Kong and in Macau, not in Taiwan. Second statement, till 1971, Taiwan represented China in United Nations. Generally, we can say this statement is correct. Till October 1971, it was Republic of China or Taiwan that represented China in United Nations. So, correct answer is option B, two only. This question is with reference to National Center for Disease Control. Three statements are given. Which of the statements given above are correct? National Institute of Communicable Diseases was transformed into National Center for Disease Control in 2019 with a larger mandate of controlling the COVID-19 pandemic in India. Now, this statement is wrong. So, easily arrive at the correct answer. Option B, 2 and 3 only. See, the National Institute of Communicable Diseases was renamed as National Center for Disease Control in the year 2009. It was given a larger mandate of controlling emerging diseases and re-emerging diseases. Second and third statements are correct. Correct answer is option B, 2 and 3 only. See this question. Which of the following statements are not correct with reference to maternal mortality ratio? The maternal mortality ratio of India has declined in 2016-18. This statement is correct as per the recent release of Office of the Registrar General India of Ministry of Home Affairs. The second statement, the southern states of India have higher maternal mortality ratio than the national maternal mortality ratio. This statement is not correct. It is actually lower maternal mortality ratio than the national MMR. So the correct answer for this question is option B, 2 only. They are asking incorrect statements. See this mains question in GS2. Do you agree with the view that a separate reservation for persons with disability should be made on par or more than the reservation for candidates from scheduled caste, scheduled tribe categories? Discuss. For this question, you may take valid points from our discussion today, and you have to discuss these points in the context of your view with reference to the question. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, if you would have enjoyed the content, don't fail to click the like button and share this resource among your friends and those who are in need of such resources. And subscribe to the Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel to get notified about new updates.